you. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for all you are and all you have done, all you've promised to do, all you will do in the future. We're grateful for you. Help us to be thankful in all circumstances for everything. God, we're thankful for the time that we have to spend together each week. The privilege that we have to come and worship you together, the privilege that we have to sing these songs, privilege that we have to hear your word read in our language explained to us, privilege that we have to respond to this word with application. God, we're grateful for this. Help us to make the most of this opportunity today. Help us to walk wisely, even as we listen this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the most terrifying experiences in my wife's life happened this week. She called me one day this week. It was in the afternoon. She had gone downtown into downtown Bardstown. She'd done a little bit of shopping. She had rounded the corner. She parked right on the street. She had both of our children with her, and she had parked right on the street. She rounded the corner back to the car. She said to our two kids, Kenna, who's age 7, and Jake, who's 4 years old, she said, "Get in the car on the side of the car that is on the sidewalk." So it's Kenna's side of the car. So she referred to it. Get in on Kenna's side. So she sees them going toward that door, watches them as Kenna begins to open the door, and then she moves around the vehicle to her side of the car to get in. As she enters the car on her side, which is on the side of the street, she notices, looking back over her shoulder, that Jake's door is open and realizes that Jake has followed her around the car and is opening the door. Despite her specific command otherwise, despite the fact that she watched him as she neared that door, he has followed her around the car and he's opened the car door. Not only does she see that he's opened the car door, but she realizes in turning back that a car is barreling toward them in the street. She sees the close call and so does Jake. In fact, he sees the car coming and runs to the sidewalk and begins to cry uncontrollably, realizing how close the vehicle was to him. Akilah realizes that everyone is shaken. She calls me. And to be honest with you, as I was thinking again through how I would tell this story this morning, I was shaken even in my study this morning to think about how close that call was. Akilah said the next night she woke up throughout the night seeing the experience taking place. Again, despite her warnings to him, despite her specific instructions, despite walking him to where he needed to be, he stepped outside of what was best and walked into danger. She'd instructed him to walk wisely. And as parents, we all do this. We try to protect our kids. You can't protect them all of the time. You can give them specific instructions. You can even walk them in the direction. You can even point them in the way they are to go and walk with them for a few steps. But at the end of the day, our children must walk wisely on their own. Come to Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15. And it is a call to walk wisely. Paul has already written in the 4+ chapters that we've studied thus far a lot to the people at Ephesus, the believers, instructing them on how they ought to live. He has instructed them on how they are to believe, what they are to believe about God and about what He has done, the work through the Father and through the Son and through the Holy Spirit. He has prayed for them on two separate occasions in the text already that what is true would be known in their lives, would be embraced in their lives, that they would not only understand these things mentally but experientially, that they would taste and see these great truths. He has prayed for them and preached to them through this letter, and He has also instructed them. He's commanded them to do certain things and not do other things. And He comes to Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15, and He says, "Be careful how you walk." We say this to our children all of the time, and despite our good, sound parenting, we must leave them to walk wisely on their own. And Paul knows this, and so he gives them another, you might say, blanket statement, another overarching command to walk wisely. This is not the first time we've heard this phrase for walk. Paul has been using this idea to encourage them. He said in chapter 2 that they used to walk in the way of the world. And then in chapter 4, he told them to walk in a manner that's worthy. And then in chapter 4, verse 17, he told them not to walk as the Gentiles. And then in chapter 4, we saw even last week, he told them to walk in love and to walk as children of light. He's talking about their lifestyle. not exactly their steps, one before another, but their lifestyle, that they are to live in a way that is worthy, or not to live like the Gentiles, or to live a lifestyle of love and a lifestyle that is consistent with the light, is an overarching command. That in mind, let's look at Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15. We'll see that Paul exhorts us to walk wisely. In fact, as members of God's family, we must walk wisely. So as I said last week, if you have the Holy Spirit of the living God, this is a command for you. You must walk this way. If you do not have the Holy Spirit, you cannot walk this way. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sorry, let's read verse 20 again. I did better. Giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Pay attention to how you are walking. The whole paragraph opens with that idea. Look or observe. Pay careful attention. Keep on paying attention. The verb look is present, active, imperative, meaning it denotes action that is in the present and ongoing, consistently, constantly. Keep on looking for how you are walking. What are we to watch for? Our steps in life. And again, this is not only our steps like Jake off the sidewalk, but our lifestyle. Be careful how you are living. Be careful to notice how you are living. Now in the ESV, it seems to attach the adverb carefully with look, that we are to observe carefully how we are walking. That's one way to do it. The other way to interpret this verse is to attach carefully to the verb walk. There are two verbs there and one adverb. And English person, you have to decide which verb you're going to place that adverb with. Look, you can do it the way the ESV has translated it. Observe carefully how you're walking. The other way to interpret it is to attach that adverb to the verb walk. So then it might read, look how carefully you are walking. You say, what difference does it make? Well, not a tremendous difference. I think the ESV has gotten it wrong here, and you should attach the adverb to the verb walk. Why? Because the entire passage up to this point, beginning in chapter 4, has been concerned with how they walk, how they live. What he wants them to take great care to do is not only to watch, they should be looking at their lives, taking an inventory of their lives, but they should be taking an inventory of their lives so that they can notice how carefully they are walking. They can discern with what kind of care they are living their lives. Why does it matter? Because every footstep matters in life. Because the direction of our lives is important. Whether it's a public thing, a public part of our lifestyle that other people see, which is obviously important, or a private part of our lifestyle, which nobody else sees, it's very important to the Lord. So we should observe how carefully we are walking, whether it's something that is known to lots of people, or something, some part of our life that is virtually unknown to any other human being except ourselves. Whether it is something that's big and large that has lots of dramatic consequences, we should look how carefully we're walking in the big areas of our lives, but also in those small areas of our lives. The things that seem inconsequential, and we'll talk a lot about what types of things he might be describing, but know at the beginning that we are to look carefully, or look how carefully we are taking every single step. Watch that we are walking wisely. As members of God's family, we must do this. The exhortation to walk wisely then is the overarching command. And it's a bit explained at the end of verse 15 and at the beginning or all the way through verse 16. Explains what it means or how they should be walking. So look how carefully you are walking, and you should be considering it according to this standard. Walk not as unwise, but as wise. He gives the negative and the positive. Paul's done this throughout the letter where he's contrasted the bad and then the good, or the good and then the bad. He does it again here. Watch how carefully you're walking so that you can discern whether you're taking unwise steps or wise steps. Wisdom is not new for the letter in chapter 5. He's mentioned this word a number of times. He's told us lots about wisdom already in chapter 1. He told us that wisdom is a blessing of God through the Son. Remember that dramatic passage that opens the letter where he tells us about the blessings that have come through the Father and the blessings that have come through the Son and through the Spirit. In that section, verses 7 through 10, when he talks about the blessings through the Son, he says that we have this wisdom through the Son. That is the true insight into the true nature of God and His plan. We know God fully because Christ has made the wisdom known through His life and even through His death and resurrection. Wisdom is a gift to the believer through the work of Christ. Remember, we looked back on John chapter 1 that told us that Jesus was God in the flesh, that no one had ever seen God, but Christ had made Him known. So we have this wisdom because of the work of the Son initially. And then he went on in chapter 1, verse 17, to request that the believers be filled with this wisdom through the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit. So the wisdom of the true insight into the true nature of God has been made known in Jesus. And Paul has already asked God that He use the Holy Spirit to bring this wisdom to the believers. So when he says to walk not as unwise, but as wise, we come to that statement, that exhortation, already understanding that wisdom has been made known and that God is working this wisdom out in us through the Holy Spirit. He also said in chapter 3, verse 10, that God is through the church making this wisdom known to the angels, to those in the heavenly realms. Remember, he said that it is the wisdom of God that's being manifest in the work of God in the church. So wisdom is both made known to us through Christ and applied to us through the work of the Holy Spirit, but it is pronounced through us as we live obedient lives to Christ in the world. As we're saved by Christ, He is making this wisdom known. Is it again? The true knowledge and insight into the true nature of God and His plan. With all of that as the background, Paul then says to the believers, now live consistently in a way that is in accord with the true nature of God and His plan. Live out this wisdom. Make practical decisions about your life. Think practically about your life in a way that is consistent with who God is and what His plan is in the world. When you have a decision on how to act in a particular circumstance, make that decision according to the true nature of who God is and the plan that He is working out in the world. Our life should be consistent. It should not be unwise. It should be wise. Well, he doesn't just leave it there. He goes on to explain it further in verse 16. How might we walk wisely? We make the most or the best use of the time that we have. The verb here to make the best use of is the word for redeem or to buy, to take full advantage of or to buy up intensely. Buy up the time that you can while you can. Translates it well, make the best use of what you have. Take full opportunity or full advantage rather of the opportunity that you have. How do you walk in a way that's consistent with God's true insight into the nature of God and His plan? You take every moment that you have seriously and you make the most of every single moment. You don't cast away moments or seconds or minutes or days or hours. You make the most of every single one. How does this translate to us, believers? We will only worship corporately on Sunday mornings 52 times this year. Only 52. You'll do lots of things this year more than 52 times. Last year we got a bonus. There was a 53rd Sunday. It was a wonderful year. I don't know if you even realized it or not. 53 Sundays last year, only 52 this year. What will you do with those 52 opportunities? Make the most of every opportunity that you have. See, by vacation or have to work or lots of reasons. You're sick. Don't bring that to us on Sunday maybe. Make the most of everyone that you can. Sunday school classes meet every single week in this building. They meet for about an hour. They fellowship for a while. They study the Bible. They share prayer requests. They meet outside of class time to fellowship with one another and to build relationships. Make the most of every opportunity that you have. We invest a significant amount of resources, money and energy and time into creating opportunities for our children and our students to continue to grow in these things, to learn the truths from God, to apply those truths, make the most of every opportunity that you have. As Leanne said, we took great care to try to select classes, about 10 of those, that would be encouraging for you and equip you to live in this world and to live wisely, to instruct you into things and encourage you. Learn for life on Sunday night and Wednesday night. Make the most of every opportunity that you have. You have, if you're a normal 21st century American Christian, have a number of Bibles in your home, different translations. You can get up every single day, 15 minutes before you have to be, wherever it is that you have to be in the morning. Make the most of every opportunity you have. Crack open the Bible and read it for yourself. Of other tools and opportunities, sermons online, better sermons than you'll hear right here, more articulate and clearer to understand perhaps. Make the most of every opportunity that you have. And here's the problem for most believers in our culture. Rather than walking wisely as they make the most use of all their time, we are mindlessly consuming garbage and wasting our opportunities. We're flicking through the updates that people are putting on Facebook, and we're reading 140 character, which seemed to be a little bit cool at the time, posts on Twitter and other things. And again, not to say that you never do those, but many of us will waste hours of the year. More than 52 hours we'll toss away mindlessly consuming things that don't matter. Not to mention the television that we watch. And what is Paul saying? He's not preaching against technology, for it didn't exist in that form. He is rather saying that we make the best use of our time. Why should we do it? He says in the end of verse 16. Because the days are evil. So make no mistake. The days are evil. And it's not just today. The days have always been evil. So don't fool yourself into believing that if you had lived 100 years ago, it wouldn't have mattered as much that you make the most use of all the time. They've always been evil. He said in chapter 2 that these days are ruled by the prince of the power of the air, that the devil, the adversary, is at work all around us, and that people and the culture at large is being influenced by the prince of the power of the air. The days are evil, and so if we don't take advantage of every opportunity that we have, we will trail into evil. If we are passive, if we allow ourselves to be carried along by the culture or carried along by what's normal in our world, we will trail toward evil because the days are evil. We can't be passive. To fight to make the best use of every second that we have and every day that we have in order that we might walk wisely. So again, back to an illustration I used several weeks ago of our lives in the whirlpool that God is longing through the power of the Holy Spirit to carry us along in the current of His work toward conformity to the image of His own Son. He is refining us, this process of sanctification. And part of our responsibility in the midst of God's working in our lives is to make the most use of every moment that we have to avoid the evil that is prevalent in our day. To actively agree with the work that God is doing. And then He takes that overarching command. As members of God's family, we live or walk wisely, and He drives it home with a couple of specific ways to do so. The rest of the text, verses 17 through 21, talk about two specific ways we might make the most use of the time we have, avoid evil, and live wisely. So really two points. The first is made in verse 17, and then the second is made in verses 18 through 21. So point number one today, we can live wisely, or we must live wisely, which means living with discernment. Living wisely means living with discernment. This is the practical application of that. And again, he uses the negative and then the positive to make his point. Verse 17, therefore, on the basis of this broad exhortation, therefore, how we might apply this, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. The negative first is don't be foolish. The word for foolish might be interpreted careless or having a lack of understanding. It might go so far as to say one who despises wisdom or lacks discretion. The person who is a fool is the person who has no discernment into practical living. Does not understand these things or have any desire to apply them to their lives. They refuse to acknowledge dependence upon God or God in his way, and they live presumptuously, thinking that they can choose their own course, that they can make their own way. So rather than understanding wisdom, wisdom that comes, again, the sole source of wisdom is God alone. Instead of looking to God for wisdom, they cast that aside and have no discernment on how to live. You might say this person, the foolish person, lives recklessly. They are willing to flirt with danger or tiptoe along the line. And I'm not talking about physically, talking about spiritually, that they live recklessly, making spiritual decisions that put themselves in a position of danger. Proverbs 1:7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, but fools despise wisdom." The writer is opening this great book of wisdom to his son. He's thinking about the next generation and wanting them to understand that those who fear God will look to him for wisdom, but the fool is the one who despises these truths. This insight into the true nature of God in our lives. Don't be foolish. Could it be any clearer than that? Don't live spiritually recklessly. Instead, understand God's will. He says in verse 17, the contrast then of foolishness is to seek understanding, or to understand what God's will is. The word translated understand means to observe or to seek mentally, to perceive or to comprehend, to fight to discern mentally. It is to do the mental exercise of trying to understand what God has said and how that applies to your life. This is active in the wise person every single Sunday morning. Sunday morning is your opportunity to practice obedience to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 17. Don't be foolish. Don't cast these things aside. Don't resign yourself to not understand them or to try to grasp what the Bible is saying. Don't hear these things and allow them to pass in one ear and out the other. Instead, work to know what these things mean. Not only what they mean, but what they mean for you. And it will take work. Some believers have been fooled into thinking that attendance in church on Sunday morning will automatically produce growth, or that if a sermon requires thinking, it's not a good sermon. Now, it may or may not be good, but God expects that the preaching of the word will cause the believer to think, to work, to comprehend it. It's not to say that we intentionally make it complicated. It is to say that in order for you to take everything that's said here on a Sunday and work it out in your life will require a mental exercise on your behalf. The verb for understand is, again, present active imperative, meaning it's happening and it goes on happening. It's work that's being done and work that continues to be done in the present and the future. We discern, what is it that pleases God? What is it that furthers His purposes? So living wisely requires a mental and spiritual effort to understand what wisdom is and to embrace it, to know God's will and to desire to follow it. In doing so, we avoid foolishness, which is a reckless life that casts aside the wisdom of God. I'd say our first inclination is not always right. So we put ourselves under the word so that we might hear the truth, the wisdom of God, and bow to it with our lives. Think of no better illustration than the one Christ used himself in Matthew chapter 7. I mentioned this before. It's Jesus' illustration. It's a good one. How foolish is the man who builds his house on the sand, and when the storm comes, it breaks it down. How wise is the man who builds his house on the strong foundation, on the rock. When the storms come, they cannot destroy it. And he says the foundation, the rock, is the word of God. Jesus is at the end of what is his most well-known sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. A sermon I think he preached a number of different times in different places. It's recorded singularly from that one preaching of it. But I think he preached it lots of different times. He gets to the end of that wonderful, remarkable sermon in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. He said lots of things about how they ought to live and how they ought to believe and how these things are worked out. He gets to the very end and he says, don't be a fool. Don't hear these things and cast them aside and build your life on some other foundation. Instead, be wise and build your house on these things. And if you build your life on these things, be protected when difficulty comes. Believers at Parkway Baptist Church, don't be fools. In order to live wisely, in order to walk wisely, you must think wisely. How might we do this? The Word of God must be central in your life. If you do not read and study and place yourself under the preaching of God's word consistently, you will not think wisely. You will be fooled into thinking the way the world thinks, unless you fight mentally to protect your thinking. Every day, every week, making the most of every opportunity. The word must be central. Prayer is also critical. Rightly informed prayers, prayers that are informed by the scripture, prayers that are encouraged. Prayer is central. We must be in constant communication with God. There must be seasons, times in which we separate ourselves from everything and fall before God. Maybe not physically or maybe physically, but certainly spiritually before Him. The other times where we pray as we're driving down the road or pray over our meal. All of those to be included, that we are putting ourselves before God in prayer. In order for us to live wisely, we must live with discernment. And it includes both reading the Bible and prayer, fellowship with other believers. Church membership, church participation is critical here. This is a wonderful gift that's been given to you. You know, the local church is a gift to you. In order that it might be enjoyed. It's a gift that comes with responsibility, but it's a gift nonetheless. So, he says, if we are to live wisely, we must begin to think wisely. That is to cast aside foolishness and to pick up discernment. Two, living wisely means not only living with discernment, but it also means being filled with the Spirit. The last few verses deal with his life in the Spirit. These are very important verses in the New Testament, understanding the work of God through the Holy Spirit. He again uses a contrast of a negative and a positive to make his point. He's getting specific now about how we live. To live wisely, we must think this way. To live wisely, we must act this way. And he's going to talk about how we ought to act, instructing them on living this out in conduct. This has been stated already throughout chapter 4 that God has done this great work in us. He has changed our identity. We have received a new identity, and that we ought to live consistently with that identity. How are we to live in consistency with that identity? Well, we ought to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He begins with the negative. The negative is, and do not get drunk with wine. First, notice that he does not prohibit alcohol altogether. To require complete abstinence is what we might call legalism. That is to put a standard upon people who are believers in Christ that is not listed in the scripture. We are never commanded to complete abstinence. Having said that, young people, to drink alcohol before you're of the age that is required by law is sin. So you are called to complete abstinence by the law. We might also say that to abstain from alcohol might be wise and certainly might be a God-glorifying decision. So while abstinence is not required, it's also not something to be cast aside too quickly because it might be beneficial to us. Now, the broad issue of alcohol consumption is only related to the text today. And it's very controversial, I understand that. But we're talking about wisdom today. We're talking about how we might think and act wisely. To that end, I thought it might be helpful for us today to see some wisdom as it relates to alcohol consumption. Again, the command is against drunkenness. I'll come back to that. But we have an opportunity to restrain our freedom. What's what we might call this? Freedom. We have an opportunity to restrain our freedom in this area, so that we might seek wisdom, so that we might live in a way that honors God. Not to say that you have to. I want to tell you, the way I want to do this today is to tell you why, under the conviction of the Holy Spirit, I choose to restrain my freedom and not participate in the consumption of alcohol at all. I say these things not necessarily to convince you one way or the other, for you and the Holy Spirit will have to deal with that later at some point. I say these things not to try to convince you, but to help you understand how wisdom might be applied here. So in the spirit of walking wisely, I choose to restrain my freedom in this area as it relates to drunkenness for six reasons. Thought this through. So the last point was, if we're going to walk wise, we must think discerningly. So in the spirit of thinking discerningly, these are the things that God has convicted me over. And I'm not saying He should convict you of them, helping you understand how we might wrestle with this. Six reasons. Number one. I don't need it. Now, I would say that all six of these could be argued against in if they're presented singularly. So if you use one of these as the sole and only reason, it can be argued against on any level. It is the combination of all of them through which God has spoken to my heart. Number one, I don't need it. It's not necessary in my life. So it's permissible, but then if it's not necessary, then I must decide if it's beneficial. That's quoting from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. So I must discern if it's permissible, then is it necessary? One, it is absolutely not necessary for my life. Number two, I set it aside also because I have an opportunity in leadership to set an example for a life that's consecrated to God. I have an opportunity to go beyond the standard that's given for us in the Bible to set an example. You say, why would you want to do that? Clear examples in the Old and New Testament of this. The priests did this in the Old Testament. They abstained from all these beverages in order that they might set themselves aside. You could take, and not just priest, but the average, we might say, layperson, if you want to use that term, in the Old Testament, could take a vow. Numbers, we see this in Numbers chapter 6. They could take a Nazarite vow to abstain from these types of activities and others also. They would do that as a way of consecrating themselves to the Lord, setting themselves aside so that they might pursue godliness in a special way. Number one, I don't need it. And secondly, it's a great opportunity for me to set myself apart for the Lord. Not to set myself apart in the eyes of people, to set myself apart for the Lord. I think there's clear evidence that Timothy was doing this in 1 Timothy chapter 5. A somewhat controversial passage that should not be. Timothy apparently was doing this in his life as well. Thirdly, I avoid it because it can be a distraction for other believers. Both believers in the church community, and then more broadly than that. It's not necessary. It gives me a great opportunity to be consecrated to the Lord, and it avoids distracting other believers by my consumption. There are many of you, if not someone near you, that might be distracted if I consumed these beverages. If they saw me out at a restaurant consuming these, or if they knew that I did, that might be distracted by that. It might cause the weaker brother to sin or to think about sin, or perhaps would be able to think of nothing other than that as I preached on Sunday. I do it to remove the distraction from others. Fourth, I do it because the danger is too great. The danger is too great. It's going to caution us, command us against the overuse. If I abstain altogether, then I avoid the line of misjudging the line of moderation. I don't have to worry about where that line of moderation is, and I certainly don't have to worry about a habit that I would become controlled by that substance at any point. I simply don't have to worry about that because I cast aside that temptation, that danger, by abstaining altogether. Again, they work together to make a case for why I abstain. Five is a financial reason. I think it's poor stewardship to spend money on something that I don't need. Now, you could come to my checkbook and say, well, you're a poor steward in lots of areas. I get it. All fits together to say these things are not necessary for me. This is one area where I feel like God has convicted me that this isn't necessary. It's a great opportunity. And I think it's a poor use of financial resources that God has blessed our family with. And then the last one, and perhaps in some ways the most important to me as I continue to live in pastoral ministry. I want people to know that you can live a joy-filled life without it. I want the person sitting here today who struggles with alcoholism to know you can live a joy-filled life without it. I want the person who's wrestled with it and watched it destroy their family or families in the past to know that you can live this life without any of that, and God is enough. He is glorified in your life, and He can satisfy every longing of your soul, every thirst you're really aiming for. Not the thirst of the tongue, but the real thirst. God can satisfy all of those. And abstinence from those beverages helps, I think, to create an example for joy-filled living, content living without it. Now, having said that, I do not say these things to hang a burden of legalism on you. I say that in the spirit of walking wisely, you ought to consider all the practices in your life. Not the least of which is this. Alcoholic beverages, you should consider all of them. That's what the first point is all about. The second point is, how is this to be applied? Well, those things aside, Ephesians 5:18 is wonderfully clear. Don't get drunk with wine. We could split all kinds of hairs about the type of beverage and what does it mean to be drunk, or what's the definition there, but they miss the point. Become intoxicated. Why? Why should we avoid this behavior? Well, it's because it leads to debauchery. You may not know what that word means. If you have a first or second grader, you're going to need to explain it to them later. Debauchery is wild living, uncontrolled, wild living. It sometimes carries with it a sexual connotation, not necessarily. It is just to live a disorderly and undisciplined life. A life with no moral standards. It's ready to yield to all sorts of temptations of pleasure. Why should we avoid the overuse of alcohol? Well, because it leads us to an undisciplined life. Because it leads toward uncontrolled living. Because when we cross the line into inebriation or intoxication, we no longer have control of our mental faculties. We can't think clearly. So we lose control and we do all sorts of senseless things. Don't do it. And he puts on the contrast with that, instead be filled with the Holy Spirit. Very important exhortation to be filled with the Holy Spirit. It is a present passive imperative. So what he's saying is that it is ongoing action that is done from the outside to us, that we are the recipients of this work and is ongoing, but we are commanded to receive it. So in the present, we keep on being filled with the Holy Spirit. In verse 18, he continues, but be filled with the Spirit. We already know about the Spirit. He's written about the Holy Spirit a lot already. He wrote about him in chapter 1. He told us that he seals us in him. The Holy Spirit does a work of sealing at salvation, the moment of our salvation. He also told us in chapter 3 that the Holy Spirit strengthens us, that his work in us is to give us the power to execute the life that God is calling us to, that it's the Holy Spirit in us that works these things out. So here he is referring to that ongoing work. Some of our Pentecostal friends may tell us that the filling of the Holy Spirit will happen over time. That you get some of the Holy Spirit and then you get more of the Holy Spirit later. They pray to get more and more of the Holy Spirit. It's not the way this verse should be understood. The verse should be understood that we get all the Holy Spirit at salvation. That when we receive Christ's salvation, the Holy Spirit indwells us. That we get all of Him. But the being filled with, or might be better translated, by the Holy Spirit, is not that we get more of Him. So it's not that we got half of the Holy Spirit and we only get the other half. It is to say that we got all of the Holy Spirit, but we come to realize all of His power in us. So we receive the Holy Spirit at salvation, but we are not yet experiencing the full power of the Spirit in us. And so Paul wants us to go on being filled by the Holy Spirit. Go on yielding to His control. Remember, we said that the power of God in us, the presence of God in us, when He indwells us, it's His power and His presence, His rule and His reign. Paul is saying here now that when the Holy Spirit continues to fill us, He is giving us more and more of God's rule and reign in our lives. We are, if you will, relinquishing control of our lives. So we're giving that control to God. Now, notice the contrast. On the one hand, we have drunkenness that leads to debauchery, which is a loss of control into all sorts of egregious behaviors, immorality, loss of control. Notice that the contrast of that is not, believer, for you to be in complete control. The contrast of debauchery is not for you to get your life under control. The contrast of it is to relinquish control to the power of the Holy Spirit. The contrast is not to keep your life inside some boundary. The contrast is to relinquish your life under the rule and reign of Almighty God through the work of the Holy Spirit. God must be in control. So then he gives us a few ways for how this might work itself out. Verses 19, 20, and 21 contain four verbs. They're participles. They all end in ing, and they are applying this work. So what might it look like for a believer to be filled with the Holy Spirit? What might it look like for James to continue to relinquish control of his life? How might he pursue this loss of control to the Holy Spirit? Well, it gives us four things that are to be done. Verse 19, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Notice that this has to do with a relationship between one another. So this is not just talking, but this is talking to one another in a way that will instruct and edify and exhort one another. So this psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs are not in this point, in this phrase, having anything to do with your relationship only to God. They have to do with your relationship to other believers. That your singing and speaking of these songs and hymns and spiritual songs is for the benefit of the person that's seated across the room or beside you today. We could try to distinguish between these three types of songs, but they are indistinguishable. So despite what our modern worship controversies might want to stir in us, they just talk about songs that are about God and His ways, in whatever form we might find them. He's saying that what you sing and say on Sundays is very important, and throughout the week, too important to the person across from you. So when we stand and we sing together, your participation in corporate worship is vitally important to the person across the way, because it's often in the singing of this and the corporate congregational singing of these things that the church is edified and built up and strengthened. And so we address one another with these kinds of words. Contrast that with all of the harsh words we've talked about already in Ephesians chapter 4. Secondly, the second way we could work this out is by singing songs and making melody in our heart. Continuing in verse 19, these songs are to the Lord with our heart. Note, now that we're singing with our relationship to Christ in mind. First, we were singing with our relationship to other people in mind. Now we're singing with our relationship to Christ in mind. And I'm so glad that it's not just singing these songs and not only making the melody, but it's in our heart. I've heard some of you sing. I'm glad it's in the heart. For if the value of your song was in the notes that you hit, we'd all be in trouble, right? But it's not in that value. It's in the value of the heart that's committed to the Lord. And so we sing these things with our heart. We say these things with the passion center of our souls. And it's a gladness of the soul. And we do them to the Lord. And so our songs are for the benefit of other people, and they're also to the Lord. He adds to that in verse 20, giving thanks always for everything to God. Thankful for Jacob singing the song earlier about thanking God or giving thanks to God. Notice that this is important to Paul. First, he says always, constantly, continually giving thanks to God. There are some days that are easier to give thanks to God than others, but we are to constantly be giving thanks to Him for everything. I thought the always part was the most difficult until I get to the end of the phrase and it says for everything. It's difficult to always give thanks. It's even more difficult to always give thanks for everything, for there are lots of things in my life for which I am not immediately thankful. It takes me a minute. And it's only by the grace of God. So how can we do this? It is by looking to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the lens through which I see all of these things so that I might be able to give thanks, even in these things, to God. So I'm not necessarily thankful for the circumstances and how they're working out, but I am thankful to God and the Lord Jesus Christ because I know that even in these things, God is working out a plan. Working out a plan for His glory and for my good. Then he adds to that the fourth, submitting to one another. So verse 21, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Some have seen here a submission to everybody, that everybody submits to everybody else all of the time. It's not practical to read it that way. I understand what they're saying and where they get it. It's not practical to read it that way. What makes the most sense in the text, I think, is to see that we are submitting as we are called to submit to each other. He's going in verses 22 and following to talk about some very specific ways that we are to submit. The husband-wife relationship, in the parent-child relationship, in the employer-employee relationship. So he's going to give us specific examples of what this submission looks like. And in verse 21, he's sort of setting that up, that we live in a way that is submissive to the authority that's been put there by Christ. And all of us are to be submissive to authority. So how might we work out this being filled with the Holy Spirit? What might be the fruit of it, and what might encourage it to continue on happening? Addressing each other in godly words, singing with our hearts to God, giving thanks to Him in all things, all the time, and submitting to the authority that God has placed in us. So this contrast, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones preached a series of sermons, preached 8 volumes of sermons on the book of Ephesians, which somebody graciously gave to me not long ago. On this passage specifically, preached 5 sermons in the text, which is kind of a small typeset, about 80 pages. So you'd think it takes me a while. Martin Lloyd-Jones took his time. He was a physician before he was a pastor, and he made some statements about alcohol. He said, when you look at alcohol, it is a depressant. Always, every time you look it up in the medical books, it is a depressant. It is to bring you down. And it makes a perfect contrast when you understand it that way. I so appreciate his analogy and his wisdom. It brings you down. That's the contrast. We give ourselves to these things that only drag us further down into the miry bog. And yet God has given us the Holy Spirit, which is a stimulant to lift us up. Cast aside those things that may drag us down and hold on to the thing that builds us up. Hold on to the thing that stimulates new life in you, the power of the Holy Spirit in us. So make the most of every opportunity and think discerningly about these things, not foolish stuff, but think wisely and make the most of every opportunity by being filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to leave you with two practical ways to apply this. We've said a lot. Number one, tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to gather right here in this room for a time of worship. And some of you can't come. I get it. You're working, you have other responsibilities and other obligations. Many of you have no other obligation tonight. You have other priorities you might or might not set tonight. But this is a wonderful opportunity. Make the most of your August the 11th, 2013. The way to make the most of it is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And a practical way to be filled with the Holy Spirit is to address one another with songs and hymns and spiritual songs. And sing songs and make melody in your heart to the Lord. And give thanks to God always and everything for all these things. And submit ourselves to the authority that is over us. Primarily the Lord Jesus Christ and other authorities as He gives. It's a wonderful chance to do that. And more than that, believers, we have to learn to work these things out. So we go back to my son standing on the sidewalk, watching the traffic go by while he cries because he got too close to the line and it almost cost him his physical life. There are many of you that have stepped out into traffic. You've opened the car door too close to the cars that are passing by. It may be in your thought life. It may be in your actions. It may be in some business deal that you're considering. It may be in your drift from the Word of God or your drift from congregational worship or your drift from relationships with other believers. You are wandering out into the street. And I say, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with the Holy Spirit so that you might walk wisely. Let me pray for you. God, I'm so thankful for Jesus Christ. God, you know, one of the agonies of pastoral ministry is watching people begin to think foolishly and then live foolishly. One of the agonies of pastoral ministry is watching people step outside the commands that you clearly give in the Bible, make a hash of their lives. And we are all prone to it. Preaching every Sunday, studying your word every week does not necessarily protect me from thinking foolishly either. What I must fight for, what we must fight for, is to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to relinquish control of our lives to Him always, all the time, in an ongoing way. I pray for your people here at Parkway Baptist Church this morning. I pray that we will be filled with the Holy Spirit. We would pursue that as we put ourselves under the Word, and that it would result in lots of beautiful fruit in this body. That we would address each other with these songs and hymns and spiritual songs, address each other in ways that glorify you, that we would make melody in our heart to you, that we would be thankful for what you are doing in and through and around our lives, and that we would submit to your authority ultimately, relinquishing lordship of our lives to Jesus. I pray for us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand, please, while we sing together?